Church, welcome to the house of God. Welcome to being the people of God. Welcome to Waterbrook Community Church. If you're visiting with us today, praise God. Make yourselves welcome. We would be a family of God for you. And just so, if you don't like handshakes and if you don't like hugs, you're probably in the wrong spot. You're probably going to get a handshake. You're probably going to get love. And if you don't, let us know. We want to know.
I'm Greg Rolls. I'm the worship leader here at Waterbrook Community Church, and I got to tell you, I had never thought I would be a part of this church, but God did. Eight years ago, maybe it's not been that long. It's been years ago anyway. Pastor Tom took me to lunch, and we were part of another church. And during this lunch, he said, God spoke to me, and he told me that you and I are going to be part of a new ministry, and he said, I want you to be praying about that. And I prayed about it, and then we prayed about it, and then pretty much I put it on the shelf and forgot about it. And sure enough, 5 years after that prayer, here we are in ministry together, and it has been a wild ride.
Hello, I'm Tom Clymer, the lead pastor at Waterbrook Community Church, and so privileged to be a part of this vital and loving congregation. Waterbrook began in July 2009 with two things. It began with a promise from God, and that promise from God occurred when I was leaving the chancellery of my former church and, as it turns out, of my former denomination, and was walking out that last time out of that congregation, and God said to my heart words that were absolutely audible. They've echoed throughout the 2.5 years of our existence at Waterbrook. He said, now watch me work. And I thought, wow, God, that's a wonderful word today, because it's a hard day to have to leave a congregation and denomination. We had 17 folks who wanted to plant a brand new congregation. We had nothing to plant it with but God. And those are the perfect assets. To have nothing on earth but God in heaven is just the perfect place to begin when you start a brand new congregation. So we began to pray together that God would lift up this brand new church. Now, over a course of just a few weeks, we were meeting in a living room, and we outgrew the living room, so we really needed someplace a bit larger. I was on the phone with a friend of mine who happened to be a Lutheran pastor from the Missouri Synod Lutheran Church, Risen Christ Lutheran Church, and I said, John, his name John Kasuf, and I mentioned to John that we were going to plant a new church. And John became excited. He said, I tell you what, let's end this call right now. I want to check on something and call you back. So he did, and the next day he called me back and said, Tom, my congregation and my leadership would like to ask if you and your leadership would be willing to plant your new Presbyterian church in our Lutheran fellowship hall. We can let you have the fellowship hall and all of the classroom facilities on Saturday nights. We can't let go of Sunday, but we can give you all a Saturday. And we just went, wow, God, look at God work. Our next prayer was for our music, because the music of your church is the window through which an unchurched world sees your church and understands your church. And we wanted to have a contemporary church, so we were praying for a way to carry out contemporary music. Within a couple of days, I got a call from Greg Rolls. Greg Rolls is a professional singer at the Alabama Theater here in the North Myrtle Beach area where we reside. And Greg said, Tom, you and I talked several years ago about the possibility, actually the certainty, that one day we would be in ministry together. I'd like to apply to be your praise team leader. And I said, wow. Greg, I said, Greg, that's going to be a lot of work and no pay for a while. And he said, that's the one I want. I want it. Well, let's get into ministry together. And so within 1 week, God gave us a place to meet, a praise team leader who brought together a small praise team to begin with. And we began in July of 2009 at Risen Christ Lutheran Church under the beautiful, loving hand, tutelage and support of Reverend John Kasouf. What a great, great guy. Well, within a 2 or 3 months, we began to outgrow their fellowship hall. We could handle about 120 folks, and we were up to 120 and growing, so it became evident that we needed to find some larger facilities very quickly. God led us to a shopping center on Highway 9, just outside of North Myrtle Beach, South Carolina, right adjacent to Little River and North Myrtle Beach, at the crossroads of two large subdivisions along a main drag going into North Myrtle Beach. We're planted in that shopping center between a bingo hall and a sports bar. Perfect places to plant a church. We rented two spaces, one for our sanctuary, one for our children's ministry. And so in the end of October, on Halloween night, what a perfect time to go write the Word of God, our congregation gathered at what would be our new facilities, and we wrote Scripture, God's Word, all over the floors, all over the walls of both of these facilities, so that not only we, but everyone who entered this facility would be standing upon the Word of God. And every time we worshiped and prayed or praised, we'd be standing on the Word of the living God. On Thanksgiving of that year, we realized that we had no ministry yet going on in the area. We wanted to introduce ourselves to the community, so we decided to do a Thanksgiving feast. Now, we didn't have sheetrock on the walls, and we didn't have carpets on the floors, but we still arranged to cook all night and provide a Thanksgiving feast for the area around us. And that day, we fed 250 to 300 folks in our new facilities, and what a joy it was. In fact, many homeless from the area came and ate as well. And we have continued that as a tradition. We just love that Thanksgiving feast. As we moved in toward our move-in date, which was 2 weeks before Christmas, we were doing an awful lot of upfit. We had to raise ceilings and put up all the walls and build most of the walls, put in the sound areas and the video, and it was just a lot to do. And we did most of that ourselves, but we came through all of our upfit on our facilities debt-free. And that included picking up a fish market right down from us. We then rented the sports bar. They closed. The church moved in, they closed. And so we took over the sports bar, and an oil change facility is now our offices and a teaching area. So we've taken in all of this within just 2 or 3 months of our existence out here in our new facilities. And God has blessed us. Our values are very clear. We want strong preaching of the Word of God. We want contemporary praise and music. Prayer is at the heart of everything, absolutely everything we do. In that wonderful name above all names, Jesus Christ our Lord, we pray, amen and amen. Now, when prayer doesn't work, God doesn't work. We just believe that is the case. We have prayer going on during every worship service. Prayer for everyone out there listening. Prayer for response. And we have had prayer for ministry going on in a very big way. Just before we moved in, our very first ministry was to the community in the Christmas parade. We noticed that only one float was in the Christmas parade that had anything to do with Jesus Christ. So we got a little hay trailer, and we put a little stable in it, and Mary, Joseph, and baby Jesus, and the children of the church, and dressed them all up and put them in the back of the hay trailer and pulled that in the Christmas parade that year. And we had more fun, the kids had more fun, but the coolest part of that is that the next year, the number of Christmas floats doubled, and this past year they tripled. So this has just been an amazing ministry, just to inspire the standing out mission of Jesus Christ in those community events. We have a strong heart for men's ministry. We know that families today are failing. There's so many kids out there that don't have both parents together, in large part because a lot of guys are failing. So we just have a heart that the guys should succeed and families should succeed, because as families succeed, the churches succeed. As churches succeed, the city succeeds. As the city succeeds, the nation succeeds. So we start right there at the dad level. And we began a brother's ministry. And in that ministry, one of our highlight moments, there's a family whose dad has been removed from the family. He's not there anymore. And there are three kids, and one of the little girls was having a birthday. So our 50 guys got together, and we went over to their house, and Mom brought her out, and all 50 of us sang happy birthday to her and just flooded her with gifts. Not only in that event, but we assigned two of our men to that family as backup for that family. And their older son was really hurting from the sting of the absence of dad, but these two guys have been able to step in and be mentors to this young man, to this boy. God is blessing that ministry powerfully. We have a strong women's ministry going on as well. They just did a simulcast for the community, a Priscilla Shire simulcast coming out of Orlando, and had folks biracially in our congregation, and they just had a great time growing in the Lord Jesus Christ. One of our areas and one of our hearts is to break down the racial barriers that are very prevalent in the Myrtle Beach area. There's an area called Atlantic Beach, and that little town is right in the center of North Myrtle Beach, and it's barricaded off by concrete barricades, so there's no way to get into it other than off the main drag, this one road off the main drag. And God placed it in our hearts to begin to really pray for Atlantic Beach. And the chief of police at that time was part of our men's ministry. So we gathered together and decided we were going to prayer walk Atlantic Beach in one Sunday afternoon. That's exactly what we did. Soon after that, we had some friends coming in from Nashville. We're going to a black trio, an African-American trio, to sing for Waterbrook. So I called the city manager and asked if they could do a concert on the beach in Atlantic Beach. And he was glad of that. He called an African-American DJ. They got together so that on the day that this occurred, not only did our trio arrive, busloads of African-American Christian bands arrived, and it lasted all day long. God got hold of that in prayer and made it more than we could possibly dream, think, or imagine. God has also blessed an effort with the North Strand Housing Shelter right up the road. It's a new shelter, and we have been blessed to be the church for the shelter. They're here every Sunday morning. We feed them. We feed them breakfast. We worship together. We've done a major fundraiser at North Myrtle Beach High School just to benefit the shelter, using a lot of the folks in our congregation and other churches. And the joy of that was to have one of the very, very lost homeless guys that we interceded with sent to Nashville, Tennessee to be in their mission, their downtown mission, came back a year clean, stood on that stage, looked out at the people of North Myrtle Beach, and he said, "I want to apologize to you for all that I did before I came to Jesus Christ." And I mean, it's just amazing. God took hold of that and made it more than we could think or imagine. Right now, one of our great outreaches to the city is Lighthouses of Prayer. We've been convicted to begin Lighthouses of Prayer all over the North Myrtle Beach, Little River, and Loras areas. We're calling congregations together and pastors together to establish those lighthouses in every neighborhood in the city. And to be a lighthouse, not only of prayer, not only do you have to be a person who wants to pray, but you have to have someone from another denomination come to your house and be part of your team, because we are determined to break down those barriers in the greater things of God. It's a great thing to be our congregations. It's a better thing to be the church of Jesus Christ, locking hands for the greater things of God and movements of God. Our world needs that, our country needs that, and our cities need that. And so we are weeping over the city and praying over the city, one neighborhood at a time. And recently we launched with 13 lighthouses of prayer for development areas in our area and growing. We're joyful about that. A year or so ago, we had Coach Gibbs come to the beach. We didn't have an office at that point, but Greg Rolls and I got together. We were praying one morning, and he was going to a NASCAR race, and so I said, you know, wouldn't it be great if we could have Joe Gibbs come and speak to men in the North Myrtle Beach area? And he said, wow, man, that'd be great. So we started to pray. An hour later, he had called them to see if that could ever happen. He called and said, Tom, we've got Coach Gibbs. He's coming. He's coming for free. He's going to send books, the new book that he's written. All we have to do is fill up the area with at least 50% unchurched men. And so that's what we did. We had 850-900 men gather at the Alabama Theater when Coach Gibbs spoke. And so many came to Christ. Miracles happened that morning. Too extensive to go into right now. But to be the flashpoint to be the prayer spot for that, and the ignition point for that, what a joy for a church that at that point was 120, 130 people. Never measure the size of your mission by the size of the challenge. You measure it by the size of your God. We open our doors at Waterbrook to our whole area, the Rotary. Home, the HOA meetings for the neighborhoods, we've invited them to come and use our facilities. We have a homeschooling group that meets every Friday, and we want to bless that. And Christian Taekwondo for kids, we bless that. And a Zumba class, we bless that, because we are a community church, so that means we want to minister to this community and let them see how great and loving a Lord we have. In our church life, we also have Kids for Christ on Wednesday nights to reach children in the area up through fourth grade. We have Merge for the middle school and senior hires, and we've recently brought on a senior high youth worker. We have Push Riders. That's a ministry to bikers, to motorcyclists. They're Push Riders because it means pray until something happens. And they have agreed that when they go out on their rides, they're going to stop and they'll pray along the way and let the whole world know that that there are bikers who like to pray for the ministry and the people around them. We do Trunk or Treat on Halloween. That's a whole bunch of fun. Fall festival at a farm nearby that belongs to good friends. We're only a little over 2.5 years old, so I can only imagine what God's gonna do in the next 2.5 years. We can hardly wait to see what God's gonna do, but we know that it's God doing it. I will tell you one story of prayer, because this is all so bathed in prayer, but I will tell you this one story about prayer. We had a little boy in our church one day, and he's the grandson of one of my dear friends. And my friend called me that day and said, Tom, please run to my house. Please get to my house as quick as you can. I think our little grandson has drowned in the pool. So when I got there, he's 2 years old, got there, the EMTs were taking him out, and it looked like he was gone. So the young mother and I just sat there, and we embraced and we prayed. And as we prayed, there was a moan. And so there was at least life there. But it was a drawn-out moan, like someone who might have had brain damage. So there was a great, great fear of either death or brain damage for this little boy. I don't know how long he was underwater. He was rushed down to the hospital, and while down there with the mom, dad's not in the picture, and the two grandparents, I called the elders of the church and said, gather the church together at the church. Don't come to the hospital. Go to the church and start praying. Just start praying with all your heart that God would spare this little boy. Well, soon thereafter, life flighted him to Charleston, to MUSC Hospital, And we all went down there. And this was on a Saturday. The next day was Sunday morning. He was on a respirator. He was non-responsive. It was a tough night. And I called one of my elders and said, "You'll have to lead worship in the morning. I'm staying right here in the hospital. Here's what I want you to do. Just start praying. As soon as you can, after you pray, start praying." Well, the next day, here's what happened. As our elder called the congregation together to pray, our drummer came down with the little boy's name written on a t-shirt, and he sat in the middle of the sanctuary, and the congregation all gathered and laid hands on him as if they were laying hands on this little boy. And their prayer time started at 9:45 that morning. By 10 o'clock, this little boy, his eyes were open. By 10:15, the respirator. By 10:30, he was up in his grandmother's lap asking to watch cartoons. By the very next day, he was home with no damage whatsoever. And that was all God, because this little boy was gone. So this is the reason I share this with you, is because this is the God we serve. This is the God that Waterbrook serves, and this is the God that your church serves, and this is the God that you serve. So believe in Him, because the word that God gave to us, "Now watch me work," is your word too. We commend this to you, we thank you, and we are so, so privileged to be a part of you in the Evangelical Presbyterian Church. May God bless and anoint you and do great things among you.
As the tear fell, the water my soul longeth after you. You alone are my heart's desire and I long to